With music, you want to penetrate the listener, you know, penetrate to the point where you reach what Miles Davis used to call a spiritual orgasm.
That's bullshit. See, that's all part of just the Miles Davis myth. Miles Davis was trying to make some money. Miles Davis was so great to see him grovel before these commercial arenas by the end of his life was really very difficult. So people had to say, oh, no, Miles didn't sell out. He's moving ahead.
What are you going to open with now? What are you going to play first?
So what?
Miles has laryngitis, so I had to interpret his whispering. The great Miles Davis Quintet. Here they are.
Synthesizers and electric instruments, you can hear those better than acoustic. So musicians learn a lot faster now.
Was I walked into the studio and I looked around for the acoustic piano and I didn't see one. So I just kind of waited around and I thought, what does Miles want me to play? And so I asked him, I says, Miles, what do you want me to play? He says, play that over there. And I looked over in the corner, that was a Fender Rhodes electric piano. And so I thought, he wants me to play that toy? Mind you, I had never played a Fender Rhodes piano. So, you know, I turned the thing on and I played a chord on it. And to my great surprise, I I thought it sounded beautiful. I loved the sound of it. It was rich, it was mellow, and it was a nice kind of blending sound.
For my first 6 months in the band, I did play piano, but there was no electric instruments. And then Miles threw one of these in front of me. Actually, you know, it was something new to me, and I would come across, you know, an instrument like this that kind of sounded like that. I thought, what is this? You know, I didn't know what it was. I didn't quite know what to do with it, but of course he was hearing something which he didn't describe to me too much. He just wanted me to play it. And then I got turned on to these little modules that you could distort the sound with. Miles is going toward a rock, bass, electric sounds, towards the elements that were more in pop music and rock and roll music.
That reverb and the tape delay, Bitches Brew, was the album that when I first heard it, I thought I was going to climb the walls and climb across the ceiling. I was on the floor beating my hands and feet. I couldn't, you know, I could hardly take it. It was so intense. It was everything that I had imagined some kind of future music to be. It was everything that I'd hoped to hear was revealed in Bitches Brew.
Well, when Bitches Brew came out, I listened to it over and over. I listened to it stone cold sober. I listened to it a little with a little change in my consciousness. I listened to it with a great change in my consciousness. In fact, I completely altered my consciousness to try to like it. I tried to like it because it was him. And I couldn't believe that it was what I heard. Because it was just these formless, long pieces that seemed to go nowhere. After a while, I felt like somebody had my hand tied down to a table and was slowly driving nails through it. And there was nothing I could do about it except listen to the hammer hit the nail. Boom! Not again. And then, bam! Oh, not that.
To Stanley Crouch and people like that, you know, they need to be reminded that it takes courage to leave all your security blanket behind and jump without a parachute.